The Kaduna State Governor, Nasir Elrufai, has expressed zero tolerance for bandits as he stated that the Kaduna State Government will not give amnesty to bandits, nor will they negotiate with them. He also apologized to the people of the state over the recent attacks in three local government areas in which scores of people were killed. I will be having a guest join us via telephone in a bit, security expert. But before he does, let's take a look at this video.
Weeks after gunmen attacked Bakali village in Giwa local government of Kaduna State, killing 13 family members and 8 others. There was another fresh attack on Kerewa, Ngwamusa, and Zariyawa community in Igabi and Giwa local government of the state. Over 50 persons lost their lives. Sorrow and tears pervaded the atmosphere, as many of the residents were seen mourning for their dead and loved ones. The governor of Kaduna State, Nasir Elrufai, visited the affected communities to mourn with those in pain. Arriving after a mass burial in company of security officials, Governor Elrufai assured residents that those found culpable will not go unpunished.
In Kaduna State, we have zero tolerance for bandits. We don't give them amnesty. We don't negotiate with them. We have asked the security agencies to just wipe them out.
He, however, asked for the forgiveness of the residents for failing to protect them from the hands of criminals and improving the security situation in the state.
The responsibility for protecting these people rests squarely on my shoulders and that of my colleagues. I also came to apologize for our failure to fully protect them. We are doing the best we can, and we are hoping that this banditry will end.
Idong Joseph, Plus TV Africa.
The situation with banditry is a worrying one. I have with me in the studio political analyst Lolu Elegbe. Thank you very much for joining us.
Good evening. Thanks.
Good evening. And we also have joining us via telephone, like I intimated you before now, Peter Eigbedion. He is a security expert. Thank you very much for joining us, Peter.
Thank you, Felicity. Good evening, everybody.
Good evening. All right. The governor is saying there is zero tolerance for banditry in the state. But I want us to start the conversation by clearing up what that banditry actually means. Because a councillor in a local government, a local councillor in that state, spoke to Voice of America and said his words, and I quote, "These men, these killers are Boko Haram. They stormed our village, killing indiscriminately. They spared no one, the young, the old, even the majorities were not spared." I want us to clear the narrative. Are these bandits or Boko Haram insurgents, do you think? I ask because it completely changes the conversation about whether amnesty comes into the scenario.
Yeah, so I think it's, again, it's for me, it's one of these issues that I think it's a false narrative, because when we start to say that the people that carried out these attacks are bandits, I think it almost takes away from the seriousness of the situation, because these aren't bandits, these are terrorists. I don't know whether or not they're Boko Haram, but any any group of people that comes into a village or comes into a town and kills people on the kind of scale that we're talking about, that's not banditry. That's terrorism. There's no other word for it. It's not, we're not talking, I mean, when you talk about banditry, this thing started, banditry, you're thinking about bootlegging in the 20s in the US, that sort of thing. This is not the kind of thing we're talking about here. We're talking about people that go almost undisturbed, are able to go into towns heavily armed, killing innocent men, women, children. So when we start to say that these are bandits, no, they're not. I don't know if they're Boko Haram, but the treatment of the federal government or the state government or the security agencies generally, the way they should handle this is the way in which you'd handle any other terrorist atrocity going on in the country.
We'll come to you on that. But let's bring Peter in and get his perspective on this. Are they bandits or are these terrorists? Because the narrative is seemingly being watered down when people coming and kill in the manner that we saw in Kaduna State.
I agree that the scale on which we're witnessing this bloodletting is one that makes us, it would be the best of us to use any other word apart from terrorism. This is pure, sheer, unadulterated terrorism. If you can attack and kill 50 people, and I heard that there were over 100 of them that rode into the town over the course of the night and the early morning, and they carried out this attack for over 2 hours and moved on like they did. The modus operandi is similar to that of Boko Haram. Boko Haram has not come out to claim responsibility, but 2 + 2 = 4. And from what we can tell, this was premeditated. It was not accidental. But from what I've heard as well, they carried out these attacks as reprisal on the communities for aiding the military in their operations against them. So I believe that definitely this is not just the act of a group of bandits. This is organized crime of the highest level, and their callousness is on a scale that is, I mean, it's not unprecedented, but it's heart-rending. 50 lives, one life is too much to lose. How much more 50 lives? So I don't like that government is kind of watered up by just claiming bandits. It gives the rest of the country a belief that, like we see, like we have seen before, or seen sentiments in that nature, that they are deliberately watering this thing down because it is a tribal or a religious war.
Okay, so the both of you seem to agree that the word bandits or banditry waters down the gravity of the brutality attack. So when you now bring into the conversation the fact that the governor is saying that he's not going to get into amnesty with these bandits, you take it back to the fact that there is already a bill in the Senate providing for the rehabilitation of repentant Boko Haram terrorists. Doesn't that invalidate the position of the Kaduna State government?
Well, it depends on how you look at it, because first of all, I think the main thing to remember is really that they're not calling these guys terrorists. They're not calling them Boko Haram members. They're calling them
How
bandits.
Do you distinguish?
That's my point, and I think that's Peter's point as well. If you look at the way Boko Haram has operated in the last few years, they go into towns in numbers, they carry out these attacks and they disappear, and somewhere down the line, the security agencies turn up. That's exactly what's happened here. So, even if you're not willing to say that, okay, these are definitely Boko Haram people, at the very least, these are terrorists. So when you talk about the bill in the Senate at the moment, talking about amnesty and rehabilitation, I get that everywhere in the world that has an issue with terrorism, you don't defeat, because terrorism is a mindset. It goes beyond the violence. There's a mindset attached to it. So the simple meaning of that is you can't defeat terrorism with only military force. It doesn't work because of the mindset. So there has to be the softer human angle, which is where the de-radicalization program comes in. Now, the problem with this is, the problem with the way it's been implemented based on what I've seen of the bill in the Senate is it has language that almost seems like you are rewarding these people for the things they've done. Someone asked me recently, how is that different from the amnesty for Niger Delta militants? I said they're two completely different things. Niger Delta militants weren't killing indiscriminately this way. They were agitating for improvements in their communities because of what had happened with oil. And what they were doing was blowing up pipelines more than they were doing anything else. Yes, they carried out kidnappings and things like that. But these guys are going into towns and wiping out entire families. That's something completely different. It's not the same thing.
Okay, let's look at some of the issues on the ground that was raised basically from the visit of the governor. He said something about the communication strategy. Peter, I'm coming to you now. He said that there was poor GSM network connection in that area. If I'm to get him right, he said the security agencies are doing the best they can, but they find it difficult to get to remote areas in good time to make a prompt intervention. 50 people died because of this lack of communication. Is there something wrong? Because a whole lot of money has been expended in ensuring that our military gets the best equipment, communication gadgets to ensure that they're able to communicate. Aren't there other ways in the 21st century that information can pass through to the military in order to stop this situation from occurring?
Let me take it piece by piece. First of all, I think the governor, for him to have come out to make that statement, I wouldn't give him much credence or lend credence what he has said, because I've not heard it from military commanders, I've not heard any of the military or police spokesmen come out to say something of that nature. Maybe he may be privileged to see some reports that give him that belief, but I mean, it is my knowledge, and I want to say this with the most respect for his office, I believe it is ridiculous. Here's another reason. You have a Navy fleet that goes into deep waters where GSM networks do not really work well. Yet they're able to communicate for miles and miles far away from different ships and different naval assets. And there's no GSM mast within those regions. Secondly, and this is where I want to talk about strategy. If you look at it, this is asymmetrical warfare. We understand, and if we've seen that this community is cooperating with the military and giving them reports about the insurgents looking around the area, it would have been the wise thing to do to at least provide some measure of protection, a buffer, to prevent this from happening the way that happened. For this to happen, and with over hours and hours, nothing was done. Nobody, I understand the governor said that some of the security agencies came in to mitigate what was happening. But in the first place, they should have realized that the possibility of reprisal attacks being carried out against communities that were helpful was high. Again, it also shows that intelligence is leaking from within the security system, because if the insurgents are attacking the communities for helping the military, then that means that there's information from inside the military that's leaking as well. There are moves within the system that are also communicating this information to the terrorists. So I'm concerned that the governor is handling this matter with thick gloves, and his tone, from what he's saying, he's not being generous with the truth. That's what I'll say.
Okay, let's look at the much publicized apology to the people of Kaduna State, heartfelt one at that, for his inability to actually protect them, which is his primary responsibility, and adds to the condolence by the presidency to the people of that state, and the promise that they will beef up security. We'll come to that. They will implement more strategies. We'll come to that in a bit. Mm. But isn't it time that the narrative on when we have violence like this go beyond commiserating with the people that lost a family, admitting faults, to situations where we can have a scenario where we don't have this violence in the first instance, and then the government comes and say, this is what we did. These are the people we've apprehended. We saved 50 lives.
Yeah, and I agree with you. It goes back to what I keep saying, that the reason a lot of these things happen is a lack of consequence. Because lack of consequences, because you, I mean, if you ask how many terrorists or bandits have been arrested in the last 12 months, how many have you heard of that have been arrested? How many have you heard of that have been prosecuted? How many have you heard of that have been jailed? I can't even remember any. They probably are, but I cannot remember. So when you have a situation when people know that they can do things like this and get away with it, there's no disincentive for them. So when the government comes out and says, we condemn the statement, issues apologies, that's all well and good, but the reality is that for the victims, it feels hollow, because every time this happens, you hear a statement of condemnation. And these days, unfortunately, it doesn't mean much anymore. That's because that town that has been attacked, or those villages that have been attacked,
previously,
they are not. No, these particular ones. Security will probably be beefed up there in the next few days, few weeks. But if the military leaves there tomorrow, or if they leave there next week, those people are still vulnerable to another attack. So it's not a question of apologizing, or if you go after the people that are committing. And what I've never understood is why it's so hard, it's so difficult to apprehend these people. Because in some cases they are coming into these towns in convoys, And if you remember, the northeast, even though Kaduna is northwest, but many of these areas are some of the most militarized regions in the country. So when you have convoys of trucks, of motorbikes, of different cars heading in one direction, where do you think they're going? Where are they going from? So I think it sort of goes back to this issue of state policing and community policing, because to be fair to the military, they are stretched and they're in different parts of the country carrying out different tasks. So they need that intelligence. The only way they can get that is through community policing. You can't do it. You can't get it any other way.
Okay. I want to squeeze in this question to Peter before we have to wrap things up. And it's a reaction from a former senator, that's Sheu Sani, who happens to be from that area, from the north. He is unhappy with the killings and has attacked Northern governors for what he said, and I'm gonna read what he said. He said, playing the ostrich, afraid of confronting the federal government and taking independent action to protect their people, end of quote. In this case, how would they go about this without shattering the seeming working cordial relationship between the executive and the state governors?
Well, I want to look at it from what the governor said. He has taken responsibility for this. Typically, if you were serious about this, I remember a time in this country where state of emergency was imposed on Plateau State, and the bloodletting was not even close to what we're experiencing on this scale. Typically, I would suggest the federal government should use the state of emergency to certain areas in this theater of madness or what is going on. But knowing the way these things have been handled with political undertones, probably will not happen. I don't know that there's a way that this matter will be treated other than being treated with consequences where there's error and there's the likelihood that leads to loss of lives like this. One life lost is too much of a price for any human being to pay. We stop politicizing these issues. I believe it's within the purview of the federal government to do what they are doing, but there should be consequences. People have been clamoring for months for the strategy to change, for the heads of the service chiefs to be either rotated or to be removed outrightly. I believe we're losing people every day. It's not just even on the civilian side. We're losing people in the army, people who are in the military. General Mamba died a few weeks ago. There are people who are sacrificing their lives, and is a price too heavy, too expensive for their families and for the country in general. The government should step up, do what is needful. Technology is also available. These areas, I mean, we will have allies in security, other countries who are willing to give us security assets like drones, manned or unmanned, to fly by these regions, to be able to give hour-by-hour reports on what's going on. Even our Nigerian Air Force can fly sorties over the region. So I believe government should do what is important to do and stop this matter with kids.
All right, Peter, thank you very much for joining us on the program.
Thank you.
And, of course, Lulu, thank you very much for making it on time.
Thanks.
Pleasure to have you. All right, and thank you for staying with us, but we're not done yet. We'll take our plots report now, and when we return, I'll be giving my take. To stay with us.
About 25 repented Boko Haram insurgents, along with their wives and children, have been received in Maiduguri by the Borno State Commissioner for Women Affairs, Hajiya Zuwaira Gambo, on behalf of the state government. They landed in Maiduguri International Airport with military aircraft and headed to Bulunkutu Rehabilitation Center. Handing over the repented insurgents, the coordinator of the Safe Corridor Program, Major General Bamdele Shafar, said the former insurgents will be well rehabilitated by the federal government and also encouraged other insurgents in the bush to surrender.
Open hand, we drop their weapons and a great peace for the betterment of all of us. Thank you.
They are Nigerians first and foremost. And they are Nigerians that have decided to behave according to the dictates of our constitution and abide by the rules and laws of this nation. They have lived out of the shores of this country and have been brought here to be reunited with their families. So ours at the Bulunkutu Rehabilitation Center is to provide them with the psychosocial support, to feed them, to clothe them, and give them some basic form of education on behalf of the government of Borno State. This is a center that His Excellency the Governor, Professor Babagana Umaru Zulu, gives so much attention to and provides us with the necessary support to ensure that these guests are rehabilitated and given the required training in various skills and then reunited with their families.
Though not versed in matters of the law, I had hoped for some clarifications to issues raised that questioned the decision of the Supreme Court. I did not get it, so as the layman that I am, I'll take what is given. The one dissenting judgment by Justice Sentus Weze that there is merit in the case for review in the court's judgment on the Imo governorship election. His position makes more sense to me. Yes, he is a lone voice in the wilderness, a really lonely part for anyone to take, I acknowledge, but he took it. So I too choose to be brave tonight and say that I agree. There was a need for review. But it doesn't really matter now, does it? Whatever our reservations about the entire matter, we must put it to rest, really, and focus on the task of growing Imo State. After all, that's all this is about, right? To serve the people and improve the conditions of their lives. I hope the governor provides quality leadership. I hope that it will pay tribute to his name, Hope, by the time his four-year tenure is up, to help us make sense of this judgment and maybe restore some belief that every disappointment is a blessing in disguise. At least I hope so. That's my take tonight. As always, we are very appreciative of your time with us on the program. We will be happy to hear your thoughts on our conversations here. So please share them using @PlusTVAfrica on social media platforms most convenient for you. I'll see you next time. Take care.